information impacting lives, enriching communities. Tonight, we focus on local government policy and how it affects you. Our moderator is Patrick Anderson.
Good evening. Welcome to the first of two local government debates organized by the Jamaica Debates Commission in association with the Purity Bakery, Miss Birdie, the Petroleum Corporation of Jamaica, and the Denewen Geddes Foundation, and staged before a live studio audience. Sign language interpretation is provided by Proven, listed on the Jamaica Stock Exchange, and broadband services provided by Cable and Wireless Business. The debates are intended to assist in identifying, clarifying, and understanding the issues being presented in this local government election campaign. This evening's debate focuses on local government policy issues and is in the form of a team debate. Guests of the political parties and the Jamaica Debates Commission are asked not to clap and cheer during the debates, except for now, when we introduce the teams. Our two teams tonight are, for the Jamaica Labour Party, Mr. Desmond McKenzie. Miss Keneisha Allen. And Mr. Charles Sinclair. And for the People's National Party, Mr. Donovan Mitchell. Mrs. Angela Brown-Burke. And Mr. Everton Fisher. Members of the panel of questioners are Miss Natalie Campbell from IRE FM. Mr. Earl Moxam from the RGR News Center. And Ms. Kimone Francis from the Jamaica Observer. Our social media editor is Ms. Marjorie Gordon from CVM TV. I'm your moderator, Patrick Anderson, and I'm from the RGR Gleaner Group. The guidelines for tonight's debates have been previously agreed and are posted on the Debate Commission's website at www.jamaicadebatescommission.org. The guidelines include: questions should not be longer than 30 seconds, and each team is allowed 2 minutes to respond to each question, and rebuttals are limited to 90 seconds. The questions posed in tonight's debate are created solely by the panel and are not influenced by the Jamaica Debates Commission in any way. In order to involve the wider public, we will be taking questions from social media. These will be managed and presented by Marjorie Gordon from CVM TV. We invite you to tweet your questions using hashtag Jamaica Debates, and you can also send questions to our Facebook page at facebook.com/Jamaica Debates. You can also view the debates being streamed live on our Facebook page. Arising from a coin toss earlier, Team PNP will make the opening statement, while Team JLP will make the final statement at the end of the debate. And now the two-minute opening statement from Team PNP.
Mr. Moderator, members of the audience in studio, Jamaica, my friends and social media, good evening. First, let me, on behalf of the People's National Party, thank the Jamaica Debates Commission for having these debates. We believe in the People's National Party that local government is critical to the development of local economic systems, the development of community buildings, and most importantly, the participation of people in the democratic process. The PMP has stand as a vanguard for including people in all spheres of life. We look at the parish development committees, we look at the local accounts committee, We look at the Social Development Committee. The People's National Party has been with the people, and we are for the people. We on this side, Team PMP, do not deal with confrontation. We deal with consultation. We don't deal with arrogance. We don't deal with trickery or promises. The PMP stands on a platform of performance. Performance in road rehabilitation and repairs. Performance in cleaning drains and gully. Performance in dealing with building applications. Building applications in 2010, we were at 40% delivering over a 90-day period. In 2015-16, we are now at 81%. That is performance. You, the people of Jamaica, you have always believed in us. We have always believed in you. Tonight, I say to you, we are for you, you are for us. I thank you. Vote PMP.
Let us now hear the Team JLP's 2-minute opening statement.
Thank you, Mr. Moderator, and a pleasant good night to the audience and to Jamaica. We are happy that the People's National Party has turned up for this evening's debate. Local government is that unit of government that is closest to the people with general responsibility for enhancing civic order, good governance, efficient public management, and spearheading, promoting, and facilitating orderly, balanced, and sustainable development within particular jurisdictions. The Jamaica Labour Party, being the party that emanated from the working class, whose founder, the Right Honorable Alexander Bustamante, was a practitioner in local government, being elected mayor of Kingston, envisions local government to be effective, professional, transparent, accountable, and service-oriented, and providing effective representation to the people within all communities. The party, therefore, has been and remains fully committed to empowering and making more autonomous the local government system and processes, while strengthening the capacity of councillors and administrative staff and the municipal corporations to deliver effective and efficient service to the people and communities, and deepening the democratic process by involving the residents of communities in the decision-making process. The Jamaica Labour Party believes that councillors are elected on their own ballot and must not be seen as extensions of the members of parliament, but must have a clear and distinct role and function. Overall, they must be accountable to the people who elected them. It was the Jamaica Labour Party that, in a real and practical way, moved the process of local government reform beyond the discussion stage that existed under the People's National Party, where it was only talk, talk, and more talk. It was the JLP that identified and documented the prototype of the ideal local authority in a publication in November of 2007, which in clear and simple terms set out the proposed legal framework, structure, governance, and financing methods of local authorities.
Thank you very much, Mr. Sinclair. Your time is up. I'm going to ask you to work with me so I can be almost irrelevant tonight. Our first question tonight comes from Ms. Natalie Campbell, and it will be directed to Team PNP.
Good evening. For years, many Jamaicans have had to deal with bad roads in their communities, carry water on their heads for miles, buy and sell in markets that are in a deplorable state, areas for which municipal corporations have responsibility. Why should anyone be interested in voting in the local elections?
I understand why anyone looking at our history would make the statement that you just did. I think where we need to start in answering that question is a recognition that for a number of years, there has been a systematic disinvestment in our local authorities. What do I mean by that? I'm talking about those days when the parish councils were gutted. I'm sure Team JLP understands very well, since it was under the Jamaica Labour Party that 5 times the councils were dissolved. when functions are moved from the local authority, placed in central government, all the resources that are affiliated with that are also moved. Failed. And so functions are returned, but they are returned without the requisite resources. What that means is that it is going to take us quite some time to be able to get back to that stage where we are able to deliver those services. Where are we today? We are not where we want to be, but we are certainly on the road to making sure that we have improved service. Certainly last year, the parish councils repaired, rehabilitated 3,200 roads. That's almost twice the number of roads that the Jamaica Labour Party had done in 2011. But what that shows is that there is an increased capacity, there is improved efficiency, and there's also improved effectiveness.
Team JLP, your rebuttal.
You know, it is very surprising to hear my friend speaking that the GLP dissolved the parish councils on five occasions. She spoke about a lack of funding. I wonder if she is aware that between February 2011 to February 2016, over some $20 billion of PRF has been pumped into the municipal corporations, over $7 billion from the municipal corporation-owned source of revenue, plus an additional $35 billion from property taxes. This money has not been used in an effective way, because if it was, then the question that you pose to my friend would have been answered. There are over 22,000 kilometers of road network in the country. The municipal authorities has responsibility for that. Almost every single drains and gullies in the country is their responsibility. You look at the condition of the markets. This administration, since I assumed the position of minister, have fulfilled promises that they have made and have failed to fulfill. So I'm saying that the mayor's answer does not touch the substance of the question that you pose. It's a continuation of the excuse that they offer for failure.
Thank you very much. The next question comes from Earl Moxam. It goes to Team JLP.
Good evening. It's been 3.5 decades since Montego Bay got official city status. Over the intervening years, under successive administrations, we have seen a decline in public order. We have seen a mushrooming of informal settlements. Today, we see rampant criminality in that western city. Is the manifestation, or are these manifestations not emblematic, at least in part, of the failure of our local authorities to effectively carry out their mandates? And if so, what are some of the specific proposals to address those concerns in Montego Bay, but not just in Montego Bay, across the island?
You have referred to informal settlements, and yes, Montego Bay does, and over a period of time, has seen a mushrooming of informal settlements. But in recent times, and as recently as 2007 and moving forward, many of those informal settlements have been regularized, as well as physical infrastructure and other amenities have been put in. So we have had significant improvements in the Providence Heights area of Montego Bay, Lilliput, as well as in the Norwood communities, which are three of the major communities that had issues in respect to informal settlements. And titles have been made available. And all of that was done in the period 2007 to 2011 under the administration of the Jamaica Labour Party, under the administration when I was mayor of Montego Bay. So we have seen significant improvement in that regard, and we want to continue that trend. Over the past 4 years under the PNP administration, they having had control of the St. James Parish Council, what we have seen, no other improvement in any of the communities in St. James in respect to development and improvement, making titles available. But what we have seen in the downtown area of Montego Bay is mass disorder. And it is something that the authority, the municipal corporation, can control because they do have the relevant legislation under which controls can be implemented. Arising out of that disorder, we have seen certain activities of high criminal nature, murders taking place within the city of Montego Bay. And there are measures that can be put in place by the municipal corporation, partnering with the private sector under the place of amusement regulations, whereby CCTV cameras can be put in, which is a deterrent to that type of activity.
Thank you very much, Mr. Sinclair.
That takes place within the downtown area.
Team PNP, it's your turn to rebut.
Thank you very much. It is obvious that Mr. McKenzie was not listening when I responded. I spoke about a historic disinvestment in the local authorities, and then I spoke to where we are today. And I did make the point that where we are today is not where we would like to be, but that there has indeed been significant improvement. But let me go to the question that was asked. I believe that part of the debates this afternoon must be to clarify the roles of the local authority and central government. And I believe that it is disingenuous for us to come here and pretend that Operation Pride activities were the activities of the local authority. No, they were not. That's central government responsibility. At the same time, we recognize that there is always some kind of collaboration that must take place between central government, local government, and the members in our community. And so we expect that. The truth of the matter is that we cannot here, as individuals who believe in local government, come and in a debate to score points, act as if we are not capable, because that is not the truth, that is not the reality. And it is time, in the discussions that we have, we speak about what we have been doing. We have been taking care of our markets, we have improved several of them, but it is true, crime is out of control. And that is primarily a central government responsibility, and the JLP government, central government, needs to respond to that.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Mrs. Brown-Burke. The next question comes from Ms. Kimone Francis. Goes to Team PNP.
Parcels of lands are out there in the communities which belong to them, but no titles were provided for them. The new strategic laws that form part of the local government reform process have given them authority to be titled, and also for community organizations to be given legal status so that they can seek funding for their projects. What kind of training program has been put in place to empower these communities and local citizens group by your party?
What I would say is that this is a governance structure. It will take collaboration. It will take people participation. We'll have to sit at the table, look at where these lands are. Some of these lands are government lands owned by the Crown, but the people have access to these lands. And so whatever it is that has to be done both with the local government and with central government. Local government by itself cannot just give away a piece of land and say, go and use it. The minister knows that even if local government has one little piece of land, the process by which you can sell or give away that land will take years for it to happen.
Indeed, just following up with that, we need to remember that we have made some huge steps in terms of the provisions in the three strategic laws, but they are just coming on stream. And what that means is that in a number of areas, we have to do the public education, we have to do the public awareness, so that our community-based organizations can be in a position to actually act as the law gives them authority and gives them the power to do. That doesn't mean that this is going to be the first time that we are going to be doing any kind of empowerment, because under Operation Pride and a number of other initiatives, community-based organizations and leadership have gone through empowerment exercises, training in terms of leadership, and that has always been part of what we have sought to do.
Team JLP, the rebuttal.
You know, Charles, let me take this one, because I'm glad you raised the question of the three strategic laws that were tabled and passed by the previous administration. It doesn't make sense. You put something in a book, it has no power, it is worthless, because the regulations that are required to make it work was never put in place. There's not one documentation within the Ministry of Local Government that speaks to these regulations. And without the regulations, a lot of what is required to make it work is impossible. We have started the process, and you spoke about the community groups. We believe in the governance at the local level, and we intend to put those regulations in place to support not just the PDCs, but to support the town councils, and to also move a step forward to municipalities. So the question of the lands, and the member spoke about what the parish councils or the municipal authorities have to do. Their minister gave himself superpowers in the three bit of legislation that was passed in Parliament that has enslaved the local authorities more. The powers of the minister in the legislation is too much. And we're talking about empowering local government. We have to take the control of the minister. And their administration did that early this year.
Thank you very much, Mr. McKenzie. The next question will come from social media. It will first be addressed to Team GLP, then the Team PNP will follow. Let's join Marjorie Gordon.
Good evening. This question is from Peter on Facebook. And Peter wants to know what will be done about corruption in local government and how people will be held accountable.
All right. Thank you. Good evening, everyone. With respect to corruption, the Jamaica Labour Party is serious about ridding the parish councils of corruption. And we have started this by making sure that if you do not submit a project, you will not be getting any monies. And we defend that, and we stand by that, because Jamaica's hard-earned taxpayers' money must be spent, and you must be able to trace how that money is spent, because we believe in transparency. We believe in accountability. We believe in seriously governing the business of the people of Jamaica at the local level. And I will go further to say, the mayor of Kingston and St. Andrew, she was one of the person who also spoke out about the fact that the monies are not being sent to the council. Your worship, I wonder if it is that you are saying that you want to spend Jamaica's tax-paying money without accounting for it? I cannot believe that that's what you would really want. We want to lead a local government authority that believes in sustainable development. And sustainable development means transparency. Sustainable development means accountability. Sustainable development means that you must be able to see how your tax dollars are working for you. So we want to make sure that when we send money to the parish council, when the Ministry of Local Government sends money to the parish council, you can walk its streets no matter what hours. You know why? Because your street will be lit. Your drains will be cleaned. And the mayor of Kingston and St. Andrew also spoke about drain condition. Mayor, you should be ashamed of yourself. And I say that because you have received $45 million prior to the coming of the rains that is associated with Hurricane Matthew. What happened to Marcus Garvey Drive? Flooded. It's a disgrace. The city of Kingston is a disgrace under your watch. And because of that, we say the people of Jamaica will make an informed decision on November 28, and they will vote for the Jamaica Labour Party, because we care.
Thank you, Ms. Allen. Your rebuttal, Team PNP.
Jamaica, the People's National Party, The People's National Party has never condoned corruption, neither in local government or in central government. We have put and start to put in place processes and mechanisms that will help to stop corruption. First, the minister knows that every year, every single local authority is audited by his ministry. We have given more power to the Auditor General's department, and they too audit each local authority every single year. Each council as an internal auditor, and if I may use Manchester Parish Council for example, no bill, no work over X amount can be paid for except we have a photograph before and a photograph after. The Auditor General will get up, the auditor will get up, go look at the work. We, the People's National Party, has placed on most of our council's website contracts above a certain sum so that the public can see it, and it means that there's transparency in the council.
You know, I wonder if we recognize that there are three individuals here in this debate and that we don't have to keep calling on the mayor of Kingston. But it's good, because what it means is that the mayor of Kingston has been working. So let's talk about what has been happening. Let's talk about it. First of all, let's go to the three strategic laws. The laws were only gazetted in February, March of this year. And what that means, based on how we have been passing our laws, is that the regulations are to come. And so, yes, it falls to the current Minister of Local Government to develop those regulations. I hope that he is also heeding his own message about the power given to the minister. So in that sense, I will have no complaint. I too thought that the minister could have sent on some of the powers that he took on to himself. I agree with that. But let us not
fool
ourselves,
Mrs. Brown-Burke.
Because this minister is not acting any differently.
Thank you very much, Mrs. Brown-Burke. We will now take a short break and invite you to stay tuned.
One of Red Stripe's latest and most important commitments is the development of a sustainable supply of local raw materials for the brewing of its beer. Under our Project Grow initiative, imported corn syrup is replaced by starch from locally grown cassava. Among the reasons Red Stripe chose cassava is its availability and neutral flavor, the availability of technical expertise, and potential spin-off for industries utilizing cassava byproducts. To date, cassava accounts for 7.5% of the raw materials in the Red Stripe brew. The cultivation of the staple has also created close to 100 jobs for young people on farms at Bernard Lodge and Wallen in St. Catherine and Spring Plain in Clarendon. We have also invested in a cassava processing plant, which produces 20 tons of cassava starch daily. With plans for expansion progressing smoothly, we expect to be sourcing 40% of our raw materials locally by 2019. We at Red Stripe are humbled by this opportunity to contribute to the growth of a great nation and will proudly wave its flag as we expand and take our position on the world stage.
The Petroleum Corporation of Jamaica has been serving Jamaica for more than 35 years. The PCJ is spearheading oil and gas exploration in Jamaica, developing renewable energy resources, and facilitating energy conservation in the public sector through the implementation of over 100 energy...
Natalie Campbell to start this segment with a question for Team PNP.
What percentage of money spent on local government goes to administrative costs compared to delivering service? And how is it ensured that administrative costs do not take the lion's share of the funds?
In them councils, currently, it's about 70-30. The administrative cost of councils we have recognized is a bit high. We have also put in place, by the creation of our local public accounts committee, which also helps and guides us in how the monies are spent. And to note that these committees are either chaired by the minority leader or by a member of civil society. We have put also in place things that will help to enhance and to reduce the cost of administration, because there are a number of things, and the HR component of the councils is a given. There are a set number of employees. We cannot cut it. We cannot reduce it. It has to take a central government decision, because what is now called the Public Services Commission, they have more authority on the employees of the council, how they are paid, their salaries are set by central government. And so it is what we called at a time in the Manchester Parish Council, taking a 10-ton truck to carry a patty. But we have started the process. We have put in the mechanisms as to how to reduce the administrative burden on council. And please note that most of those funds come from the local funds that the councils receive. The only fund we get from central government are those that pay councillors.
Before the rebuttal, just for clarification, Mr. Mitchell, you said the ratio was 70 to 30. 70% administration?
Administrative, 30.
Service.
For services.
The rebuttal, JLP.
Well, I will accept what my good friend has said across there, but what it then says to the local authorities is that you must get out of your office and increase the potential revenue that the council has. This is a publication of the Western Mirror, property tax, which comes back to the council in one form or the other. Below target, St. James falls behind in property tax collection under the PNP administration. If we look in St. James, there are lands, and I'm certain this applies right across the country, that there are lands that are owned by the council, occupied by persons. When I got to the council in 2003, the PNP administration had rental owing for properties owned by the council from 2000, over 20 years. And we had to catch up on all of those and to bring in the revenue for the council. In fact, the St. James Parish Council turned out as being the council that generated the highest revenue throughout Jamaica during my administration. Presently, and I have advised and given guidance to the present mayor of Montego Bay, that the Bogue lands, that there is rental outstanding in the excess of $24 million that he has failed to collect or make any effort to collect, while persons with large buildings occupy. So the councils do have within their ability to increase the revenue and to ensure that there is sufficient revenue available to deliver services to the people in an efficient and effective manner.
Thank you very much. The next question comes from Earl Moxam. It is for Team JLP.
I haven't done the math on the gender composition of the candidates for this year's local government election, but I would just like to take you back to the report of the National Advisory Council on Local Government Reform in 2009, in which it stressed the importance of inclusion of women in as much of the decision-making processes as possible at the local governance level. I'm therefore asking whether you would support the establishment formally of a mandatory minimum number of seats in the councils across Jamaica for women.
All right. Let me say that the Jamaica Labour Party believes in qualified people. Women are qualified, men are qualified, and let it be stated clearly that we believe in gender equality. We also believe in young people. We will not push them aside. We believe in equal rights and justice for all. I will say to you, once you are qualified to serve, your gender should not be something that should be placed on the table. What matters when you're talking about people's lives, when you're talking about legislation, when you're talking about national governance, local government governance, that is so important. Gender should not be something that you should look at to say, because I am a woman, I want no one to elect me merely because I'm a woman. I want to be elected because I've demonstrated that I can effectively carry out my duty. So I say to you, once you're qualified, you should be given the opportunity to serve. However, the pathway must be clear, where you should not be affected on the basis of your gender, meaning there should not be a block because you're a woman. So I say people should be elected on the basis of qualification. But since this is a local government debate, let us get back to what the local government ministry is doing about making sure that the people that offer themselves up to you are qualified. The local government ministry, headed by the minister, the Honorable Desmond McKenzie, I've started discussion with mine, UTEC, to ensure that there is a local government course. That is important. For many years, people believe that councillors are people who know very little. And we are changing that dynamics. We are redefining local government because our vision for local government is to make sure that Jamaica's local government system becomes a first world local government system, delivering effective service for the people of Jamaica because that's what they deserve. Only the best, and the
rebuttal,
JP is providing that.
Thank you very much. It is amazing to hear individuals talk about simple qualification when it comes to women and being involved at this level. I say that because when you are combating years of systemic discrimination, you need a response that recognizes that women are coming from behind. They're coming from behind because some of our very own don't understand those issues. Some of our very own don't understand that unless systems are put in place to encourage women, we don't have babysitters, we don't have wives at home to cook for us. We have to share the duty of care, and therefore we need extra special help. But I'll go further. I am not interested for this second in what the minister is doing, because the minister comes after parties have elected individuals, selected individuals to serve, and after they have been elected. We need to put that responsibility on the parties. The People's National Party is clear that we need, whether it is gender quota, we need to ensure that what we do encourages the participation of women in politics, and that when they come, they have the support that allows them to succeed. But let me just step back for a little bit. You know, I heard one of the members talking about property tax target. Let me just remind persons that in 2011, 2012, when we had an increase in property tax, 2012, 2013, when PNP came into power, we raised far more taxes in that year than the JLP did the year before.
Thank you very
That's
much.
Because
Thank
of
you very
our
much,
own
Mrs.
Efficiencies.
Brown-Burke. Thank you very much. Team PNP, you're up next. The question comes from Kimone Francis.
There are more than 100,000 streetlights. Preliminary audits done have indicated that at any one time, at least 20% of them are not working. But the arrangement approved by OUR with JPS is that whether or not these streetlights are working, JPS still gets paid by taxpayers' money. Why should people vote?
Okay, that has always, streetlights has always been a vexed issue. It has been a vexed issue because every single time we have a meeting and a discussion with individuals in the community, that's one of the first things that is raised, what's happening to our streetlights. The truth is that we really need a new arrangement. We need a new arrangement because the councils have responsibility for streetlights. The current construct includes a discussion primarily between the minister and JPS, without the local authorities there. We are very clear that the time has come for the local authorities to be part of the discussion. In fact, the KSAC would have not so long ago moved a resolution that was supported by the council that situation needs to be clarified, that there needs to be a proper audit. We need to have an arrangement in place that allows us to, for that 20%, discount the monies that are paid, and that we can, from time to time, be clear on what's working, what's not working. In fact, coming out of the resolution that was moved, the JPS actually wrote the Kingston and St. Andrew Corporation just a couple weeks ago for us to begin a discussion about how we can approach that issue so that the people who we serve are not the ones who are going to be at the brunt of it, because we all know the level of crime, and therefore having streetlights working is important. As we speak right now, Minister, I'm not sure if you are aware, as we speak right now, there are individuals pinned down in your constituency again again victims of crime and violence. That is something that is out of control that we need to get take care of.
Rebuttal?
You know, I would have hoped that the members of the PNP would have had some discussions with the former minister when in fact he didn't know that the previous administration entered into an arrangement with the new electricity license that has given total monopoly to the Jamaica Public Service Company as it in regards to streetlights. The crisis in the country that exists now with the streetlight situation has been thrown wide open because a decision was taken and the then Minister of Local Government did not raise a finger objecting to the decision that his government and cabinet took. The country is being held at ransom because the Jamaica Public Service Company presently has an arrangement that they should now move from the outdated lighting system that we have to a new energy efficient system. But when you read the agreement that was concluded between the previous government and the Jamaica Public Service Company, there's a starting time you must commence in December. But it says nothing more. The country presently does not know how much lights there are in the country. An audit was done, it was a daylight audit. The audit says that there's 109,000 and they eliminate some and brought it down to 99,000. You know, so we have to understand where we are in terms of street lights.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Mr. McKenzie. We will now take another short break and invite you to stay tuned.
For nearly a decade, thousands of lives and communities have been enriched by the efforts of the DNG Foundation. Through Community Link-Up, communities island-wide were fortified with recreational areas. Our REACH program invigorated communities and schools across the island, facilitating the development of proficient nation builders. The outreach initiative of Red Stripe through the DNG Foundation has nurtured the skills of many through the Learning for Life program. The DNG Foundation, impacting lives, enriching communities.
The Petroleum Corporation of Jamaica has been serving Jamaica for more than 35 years. The PCJ is spearheading oil and gas exploration in Jamaica, developing renewable energy resources, and facilitating energy conservation in the public sector through the implementation of over 100 energy efficiency projects in hospitals, schools, health centers, and other government facilities. The Petroleum Corporation of Jamaica, fueling Jamaica's development for over 35 years.
You didn't know that it's illegal to show anybody a ballot paper who you vote for? Your vote is secret. And if you show anybody at all who you vote for inside the polling station, the presiding officer will declare your ballot spoiled.
The law protects the secrecy of your ballot. You may be fined up to $80,000 or be imprisoned for up to 5 years for voting openly. Remember, you must mark your ballot behind a screen. Fold your ballot so that the mark is not exposed. If you expose your mark, your ballot will be declared spoilt. No one should ask you to expose your ballot, as this is a criminal offense. Your ballot cannot be traced back to you once the counterfoil has been removed. Your vote is your secret. Free and fair elections, it's up to you.
One of Red Stripe's latest and most important commitments is the development of a sustainable supply of local raw materials for the brewing of its beer. Under our Project Grow initiative, imported corn syrup is replaced by starch from locally grown cassava. Among the reasons Red Stripe chose cassava is its availability and neutral flavor, the availability of technical expertise, and potential spin-off for industries utilizing cassava byproducts. To date, cassava accounts for 7.5% of the raw materials in the Red Stripe brew. The cultivation of the staple has also created close to 100 jobs for young people on farms at Bernard Lodge and Wallen in St. Catherine and Spring Plain in Clarendon. We have also invested in a cassava processing plant, which produces 20 tons of cassava starch daily. With plans for expansion progressing smoothly, we expect to be sourcing 40% of our raw materials locally by 2019. We at Red Stripe are humbled by this opportunity to contribute to the growth of a great nation and will proudly wave its flag as we expand and take our position on the world stage.
The Local Government Debates 2016 are presented by the Jamaica Debates Commission in association with Purity Bakery, Miss Birdie, Petroleum Corporation of Jamaica, Securing Jamaica's Energy Future, Deno and Geddes Foundation, Impacting Lives, Enriching Communities.
Welcome back to the first in a series of two local government debates presented by the Jamaica Debates Commission. If you're just joining us, welcome. Before I move to our next segment, and this will be a social media question, might I just remind our debaters tonight to please stick with the time limits. The clock is well within your vision. I do not want to interrupt you, but if I have to, I will. We invite Marjorie Gordon, our social media editor, to start this segment with a question from social media for both parties, Team JLP first, and then the Team PNP afterwards. Marjorie?
Aronica Hyman on Twitter wants to know what will be done to address the issue of poor garbage collection right across the country.
We understand and we appreciate that there has been a breakdown in the garbage collection right across the country. The existing fleet of the National Solid Waste Management Authority is very old. And the facts are that the trucks that were to have been brought into the system because of failure to put the proper mechanism in place to bring those trucks into the island. Unfortunately, when I took responsibility for the ministry, I had to tidy up the mess that was left. The trucks will be coming in by the end of February. We are making arrangements. Only today, our instructions were given for funds to be released to the National Solid Waste Management Authority to hire additional trucks to ease the backlog of garbage collection that is spreading across the country.
And let me continue to say, let us look at the root of solid waste. Let us look at how solid waste was conceptualized. The function of solid waste, when it was conceptualized, was a regulatory body, right? So, solid waste being a regulatory body and also an operation body really put a strain on the National Solid Waste Management. That is why we support the 9-member enterprise committee that have been established with persons who are expert at garbage management, garbage disposal. Also, I say to you, the Jamaica Labour Party, in dealing with garbage in Jamaica, is entering into what we call waste to energy. We are ensuring that the waste becomes something of economic benefit for the people of Jamaica, economic value. Then, after that, solid waste will be able to go back to its core function, acting as a regulatory body.
Rebuttal?
Let me state emphatically that solid waste does not rest in the parish council. And any notion to suggest that, that is not the truth. Solid waste is in the hands of the minister. I want to also state that under the People's National Party, in spite of the tight fiscal policies that was created by the IMF, under Minister Arscott, we did a lot to deal with the garbage. We admit that probably enough was not done. But again, I said, based on the tight fiscal policy, before the minister left office, as I am now conceded by Minister Desmond McKenzie, 17 compactor trucks were ordered. I am yet to understand clearly from the minister's statement what held up those 17 trucks. And after 9 months, I would still want to say what caused this pileup of garbage in Jamaica today.
The first thing we have to do in terms of this 9-member enterprise team, they might be experts in solid waste, but But if you are going to privatize a property that doesn't belong to you, the first thing you really need to do is to consult the owners. So just a little piece of advice to the minister to take back to cabinet, just so that the individuals will know that that property does not belong to local government. Then the next thing I want to talk about is that, let us be clear, that we keep talking about when solid waste was came into being. Listen. We're talking about waste management. The National Solid Waste Management Authority is an entity that took up that responsibility at a point in time. Remember, those were some of the same functions that were vested in the local authority that were taken away by the JLP administration. All of the resources that we had to take care of it also went. When it came back with absolutely nothing. The Marcus Garvey Drive, let me just deal with that for a second. Marcus Garvey Drive is being constructed. That is the responsibility of NWA and the minister. You're too young to understand.
Thank you very much, Mrs. Brown-Burke. Thank you. Thank you very much. The next question is for Team PNP, and it comes from Natalie Campbell.
A unique feature of the Portmore municipality is a directly elected mayor. This has not been the case for over 3 years. What level of systemic problems does this situation highlight in local government, and what is being done to address it?
In terms of the direct election of our mayor and the pilot that was Portmore, I think that it reveals a number of issues. Part of the idea always was that Portmore is a pilot, that in the operation of it, we would look at what were some of the issues. There are several issues that we need to look at. One is really the authority that's vested in the mayor. We, all of us, would have been there hearing the kind of imbroglio from time to time at the Portmore Municipal Council in terms of a decision being made by the minister, by the mayor, and a decision being made by the councillors. The truth of the matter is that we would remember that Minister Arscott took to Parliament a bill that sought to remedy some of the issues that arose in terms of the lack of that direct election of mayor. The truth, though, is that we also need to look at even this, the attempt at the present government to sneak in like a Nicodemus in the night, a solution that they had not even discussed with individuals in Portmore. Let me tell you, local government is not about talk, it's not about big bravado. It is serious work, it is respecting people, it is making sure that we are inclusionary, and it is making sure that even in those difficult times when decisions need to be made, that we consult individuals who are going to be affected by that. You know, today I'm extremely pleased to see an actual minister talking here. The last time we met in a debate such as this, the individual with responsibility could not even go into the big house because it was a department. So it is good that based on the discussion that we had in the last debate, the JLP are at least seized of the importance of placing an individual at the most senior level with responsibility for local government.
Team JLP.
You know, it is very frightening listening to the comments from my very good friend. It is quite clear that the People's National Party continue to deprive the people of Portmore of their God-given right for proper representation. What has been done is an act that was put in place, something that I spoke about when I was in the Senate in 2002, raising objection about the concept that was being put in place. The concept is a good one, but based on how it has been constructed, it will never work. The people of Portmore cannot have the kind of representation that is required for them to become a full municipality. The councillors are sitting both in the St. Catherine Parish Municipal Corporation and in the Portmore Municipal Corporation. The bill that the minister, the then minister, took to Parliament was a bill to further enslave Portmore as a political enclave for the People's National Party. It is not about giving them the autonomy. It is not about giving them the freedom. And what we intend to do, We are going to change it because we want the people of Portmore to have the proper representation that they deserve under the local authority.
Mr. McKenzie, a follow-up here. Am I interpreting you to be saying that your party is not in favor of further direct election of mayors across the country?
I did not say that.
I'm asking.
The existing pilot project now has not worked. It is a concept that we support. It is something that we believe in. But we will have to ensure that the systems are put in place, the system works before it can be tried in any other part of the country. It is something we believe in, but in the present shape, it is not workable because of the existing arrangement that exists. It's something that we will support once we put the proper mechanism
in. Thank you very much. Same for you, Team PNP. Where are you philosophically in further direct election of mayors across the country? Is this something you believe in?
The People's National Party believes in direct election of mayor, but I'm not sure if you actually heard Mr. McKenzie. He says we want them to have. What is at the heart of local government is not what we think they need to have. We need to go to individuals. We need to go to those who we are serving. We need to take from them what they would want to have. In fact, when Minister Arscott took that bill to Parliament, it was based on consultation in Portmore that said here is what we believe would be a good way out. So it is not about sitting in your office and because you have brains or whatever, you are going to determine what is good for them. Those days of Bakramasa are over.
Thank you very much, Mrs. Brown-Burke. Earl Moxam has the next question. It's for Team JLP.
Well, I'm going to name three geographical locations. The resort towns of Negril and Outerios and the university town of Papine. There have been proposals over the years for them to be given municipality status, and there are various options now under the new act. Is there that plan, and what's the timetable for implementation?
Well, the cabinet gave instructions, and we have already started the discussions in regards to Negril, and those discussions are well advanced. We'll have to first look at Negril, put that system in place before we look at the other two communities. I know Papine is of great concern because of its local and what it entails. Recently, there has been a stakeholders meeting in Outerios where those discussions have started, but the facts are that we are now concentrating in putting the Negril concept in place.
Certainly. You know, the minister says that the cabinet has given instruction. The first thing to understand is that the current laws actually set out a process by which we actually arrive at these town councils and municipality. The Papine area, for example, they have long been having their discussions. So I'm actually surprised that the minister would give instructions for Negril. Maybe there are some vested interests there, some private reasons why Negril should be the one that you give instructions. When in fact, I am sure, based on the discussions that they have been having, they have had stakeholder meetings, they have come to the KSAC with the proposals, and we have been working through that process. So I'm just going to suggest to Mr. McKenzie, when he gets back in office, just speak to the members in your team, because they certainly, as the technical individuals who have been part of the discussion, would understand where we are and that Papine is almost ready to go.
No.
The next question is for Team PNP. It comes from Kimone Francis.
Outside of the parochial revenue fund, with the empowerment under the new Finance and Financial Administration Act, what policy is being contemplated to increase funding for local government framework infrastructure that would improve road maintenance and rehabilitation?
There are a number of initiatives that councils, or most of the mayors, have taken. We look at carry-led, we look at some other arrangement, like the twinning arrangement. We have come up with other creative ways. We have increased our own source. We have, and just to go back to something that the minister said, or Charles said, in 2012, we were the one that raised the property tax. We recognize that at this juncture, we would not want to raise it again, but we are looking at means and ways of how we can have greater compliance. So we have been busy, all mayors, 14 of us, have been busy over the past 4 years, going five, looking at means and ways how we can come out of that box, so to speak. Because as was reported, we got less than 30% of our monies from central government. The time has now come that central government will have to look in means and ways of how we can improve what comes to council. Because all of the discussion that we have had so far is looking at how we can improve garbage collection, looking at roads, looking at all the other amenities that we can improve to our people. But as I said, we are the one, the People's National Party, who have charted that course on the local government reform.
You know, I still have some time, Desmond. Property tax, and the minister knows that, for example, Manchester has employed persons in the tax office. Their sole responsibility is to try and persuade people to pay their property taxes. He knows we're having a problem with central government. We have rented an office. Up until now, we are still having problems in getting those people in that office so that they can go out there. We deal with gentle persuasion. We understand, and it is not at this time. The People's National Party is not proposing to put any new tax burden on the taxpayer. We want to go out there because there's a sum of money, a whole lot of money
out
there.
Thank you very much, Mr. Mitchell. Thank you. The rebuttal.
You know, I find it really amazing. You're offering an excuse for incompetence. There is no need for central government to pump more resources into the municipal corporations. They have the potential to earn the revenue. The revenue base are there. What are they doing with this money? There's a particular fund that by law, they are required to save 20% of that, the SGR. Those funds are to be left in reserve for cases of emergency. Almost 80% of the municipal corporations have zero money in those accounts. What have they used those monies to do? The monies are there, but they do not have the requisite ability to go out and to maximize their potential. They have thousands of acres of lands sitting down. Senator Sinclair made a point about rentals. Millions of dollars is owing to the municipal corporation out there, and all they are depending on is something from central government. They have the potential to earn, and this administration is going to put the local authorities on a footing that they can earn their keeps, because it is time now that central government takes its hands off the wheels of the local authorities.
We go back to our social media friends and to take our next question. Marjorie Gordon has it. It'll be first answered by Team JLP and then Team PNP. Marjorie?
Well, residents in Portmore have been asking, and they want to know what is being done or what will be done as it relates to fogging in the area, because they're concerned about the mosquitoes that are in that municipality.
Well, before getting deeper into that question, I want all of Jamaica to understand that there are 14 municipal corporations in Jamaica, all of which are led by the People's National Party representative. Let us look at the real function of local government. Care of markets and parks, cemeteries, care of parochial roads, licenses for barbers and hairdressers, building plans approval, health, public health, that is what fogging would fall under. Now, Portmore consistently have supported the People's National Party. In return, what they get? Mosquito infestation. No wonder why it is that almost all of us were infected by chikvir. What you're seeing is poor management of the corporation by the People's National Party. What it is that the Jamaica Labour Party have done to fight against mosquito? What the Jamaica Labour Party have done was creatively utilize science to make sure that we eradicate mosquito. Little fishes were thrown into drains to eradicate mosquitoes. No, every single Jamaican, Portmore, I am speaking to you. If a mosquito have ever bitten you in your life, do not vote for the PNP. If a mosquito have bitten you, avoid the PNP. Because you have consecutively support them. And what happened to you? Mosquito bite you left, right, and center. I say to you, support a political party that is going to take public health seriously. Support a political party that is going to make sure that your drains are kept clean. I want to also move away from the mosquito issue to look at small businesses, because we speak about how it is that the local authorities will make more money. If you have a big corporation, they might well employ 1,000 persons. Think about it, if you have 1,000 small businesses, if they employ
just 2 persons. Thank you very much, Ms. Allen. Thank you very much.
It's a multiplying effect.
Team PNP, your response?
I'm not from Portmore. And there seem to be that there's a lot of JLP mosquitoes in Portmore. But, you know, let me go back first to a point that the member from the Jamaica Labour Party raised about developing a course in local governance. If the current minister attended meetings like CALGA and ALGA, he would have known that through CALGA, the University of West Indies St. Augustine campus offers such a course, and it doesn't need to reinvent the wheel. All you have got to do is to just ask for the document. But I would like to ask, what is it that they have done with the funds that they say they have spent on the Zika virus? Today, as we speak, there are a number of Jamaicans that have worked dealing with the mosquitoes issue, and they still have not received one dime.
It is also very sad, though, that as I listen to the member from the JLP, that we seem to want to politicize health. And I am sure when the caller from Portmore sent in, you know, the request or question. I mean, I think wherever he is, he's very shocked at the answer that is coming from the Jamaica Labour Party. We cannot at this time in our nation history be talking about whether PNP mosquito or GLP mosquito. The fact is, we must clean up the garbage. We must clean up the areas so as to let people live in a healthy environment. And I am asking, do not let this debate and unhealth become a political one.
And the minister just need to make sure that the public health department does the fogging. That's the question that was asked. Look at the schedule and go do the fogging. Because
thank you very much, Mrs. Brown-Burke. Thank you very much. We will now take our final break and invite you to come back with us.
One of Red Stripe's latest and most important commitments is the development of a sustainable supply of local raw materials for the brewing of its beer. Under our Project Grow initiative, imported corn syrup is replaced by starch from locally grown cassava. Among the reasons Red Stripe chose cassava is its availability and neutral flavor, the availability of technical expertise, and a potential spin-off for industries utilizing cassava byproducts. To date, cassava accounts for 7.5% of the raw materials in the Red Stripe brew. The cultivation of the staple has also created close to 100 jobs for young people on farms at Bernard Lodge and Wallen in St. Catherine and Spring Plain in Clarendon. We have also invested in a cassava processing plant, which produces 20 tons of cassava starch daily. With plans for expansion progressing smoothly, we expect to be sourcing 40% of our raw materials locally by 2019. We at Red Stripe are humbled by this opportunity to contribute to the growth of a great nation and will proudly wave its flag as we expand and take our position on the world stage.
The Petroleum Corporation of Jamaica has been serving Jamaica for more than 35 years. The PCJ is spearheading oil and gas exploration in Jamaica, developing renewable energy resources, and facilitating energy conservation in the public sector through the implementation of over 100 energy efficiency projects in hospitals, schools, health centers, and other government facilities. The Petroleum Corporation of Jamaica, fueling Jamaica's development for over 35 years.
I love being Jamaican and everything about our little island. Our music, beaches, and sunshine are one of a kind. But what I love most is our culture and how we share the love with each other. Share the love with Miss Birdie. Miss Birdie, love is the best ingredient.
Decade, thousands of lives and communities have been enriched by the efforts of the DNG Foundation. Through Community Link-Up, communities island-wide were fortified with recreational areas. Our REACH program invigorated communities and schools across the island, facilitating the development of proficient nation builders. The outreach initiative of Red Stripe through the DNG Foundation has nurtured the skills of many through the Learning for Life program. The DNG Foundation, impacting lives, enriching communities.
The correct way to vote. Step one, find out exactly where you are to vote before election day.
Adrian Atkins.
Step two,
thank you very much.
Present your voter's identification card and follow the instructions of the presiding officer. Step three, once your identity has been verified and your name is found on the voter's list, you will be issued a ballot paper. Step four, go behind the voting booth and mark an X with the pencil provided beside the candidate of your choice. Then, fold your ballot twice, leaving the flap out. Step 5. Give the ballot to the presiding officer. Then, dip your right index finger in the electoral ink and watch while your unopened ballot is put in the box. Step 6. Leave the vicinity in a peaceful manner.
Your vote is your voice. Make it count.
The Local Government Debates 2016 are presented by the Jamaica Debates Commission in association with Purity Bakery, Miss Birdie, Petroleum Corporation of Jamaica, Securing Jamaica's Energy Future, Denowan Geddes Foundation, Impacting Lives, Enriching Communities.
Welcome back to the first in a series of two local government debates presented by the Jamaica Debates Commission. And if you're just joining us, welcome. We invite Natalie Campbell to start this final segment with a question for Team PNP.
Some local representatives are not seen or felt until election time. How is your party ensuring your local representatives work and not just wear the title of councillor?
You want me to get it? The first thing, you know, you want to
go?
Okay. That's a very good question. And it is true that there are some representatives that are seen and not felt. What the People's National Party is doing, we would know that for this election, for example, there are a number of sitting councillors who are not returning. They're not returning because we have built in a system of democracy, but also a system of accountability, because we believe in participation, accountability, responsibility, and transparency, which is the same set of values that we bring to whatever we do in the local authorities as well. And so what would happen is that individuals would face some kind of evaluation, some kind of test, and the persons that they are going to serve would also make some kind of determination. But I also want to interject here, because a comment made from one of the colleagues on the GLP team about don't vote for a PNP if a mosquito has ever bitten you. Those are the kinds of statements that are made that allow individuals to believe that those of us who have placed ourselves in a position to offer leadership at the local government level are frivolous, are not serious, and are not ready for it.
Team JLP with a rebuttal.
It is clear that what Mrs. Brown-Burke has just said, that some councillors will not be returning because they, on the PNP side, are focused on other things,
And I just want to declare, and it confirms what has been said, that the People's National Party has been the most corrupt administration in the history of the Caribbean. Let us look on what they have been doing in some of the councils where the persons have not been seen then. We had issues in the Hanover Parish Council. We had issues in the St. Mary Parish Council. We had issues of corruption in the Manchester Parish Council. We have had other issues in the Clarendon Parish Council. The Contractor General has been looking into many of those issues. One could go on and look at other situations that would have arisen that would lead to us making that declaration that the People's National Party has been one of the most corrupt administrations in the history of the Caribbean. And that gives the clear answer to why they have not been seen. Nepotism, dealing with family issues, and having the hard-earned taxpayers' dollars not going to service delivery, but to their families. That has been what has mired some of the councils and the councillors.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Sinclair. You have a follow-up question, Natalie? Next question is from Earl Moxam. It goes to Team JLP.
The National Advisory Council on Local Government Reform also recommended the formal incorporation of the Parish Development Committees, the PDCs, that model in local governance. How far has that proposal been taken? And in respect of their ongoing functioning, have they been receiving the funding necessary to carry out their functions to the extent that they have those functions at this point?
I'll take it out. The PDCs are still operating. There are serious challenges with a lot of those organizations. The question of proper accounting, a lot of them have not been audited. The source of funding that was provided at the inception of the organization has run out. There is no dedicated funding within the Ministry of Local Government to support it. The funds have to be taken from the parochial revenue fund to support it. But there is a problem. And the problem is that many of those organizations have not been audited. A lot of them have been engaging multinational and international organizations in seeking funding for programs. We commend them. But the reality is that there is a question as to in regards to how a proper accounting mechanism is done. I have been engaging them in discussions on the matter, and we will continue to engage them. There is a place for it. It is something that we welcome. We want to work, but it has to work within the systems of the law. If the local authorities are asked to be transparent and accountable, then these development committees must also be transparent and accountable.
It is quite sad to listen to the minister to say that the PDCs need to be audited. I believe you have the power to do so. I speak for my own parish, St. Elizabeth, and I can speak for Manchester Clarendon. We have had a very successful PDC. These are persons from corporate Jamaica who have come in and sit down with us as council to develop the parish. I just received last year the sustainable development plan for my parish. And I want to say, I believe to come and to say that the PDCs are not functioning because they need to be audited. I think, Minister, you need to take another look on that. But just to go back to what Charles said about corruption and the PNP, whatever audit is being done now, I challenge people to go as far as they can, go back and audit previous councils, previous administration, whatever. As to the Hanover Parish Council, I have a quote in my hand from the minister himself. Hanover's PC back in local government good books. We need to stop giving people's impression that all of us, Charles, whether PNP or JLP, we are all corrupt. That is not so. There are systems in place to put check to put checks and balances.
True.
We have observed the Office of the Contractor General. We have put in the local account, local accounts committee. We have put in place, and we are willing to say, as stated before, the PNP does not condone corruption in any way, shape, or form.
Kimone Francis has the next question for Team PNP.
There has been debate on whether the local government elections and the general election should be held simultaneously. What impact would such a move have on voter apathy and the process of representation in Jamaica?
My understanding of the issue is that it's a very complex one in terms of changes that would be required by law to allow both of them to take place. I know that there is an argument about savings. I know that persons are hoping that because there's a higher turnout and interest in the general election, that that would carry with it greater interest in local government. But let me tell you, we will have no greater interest in local government if when we have an opportunity like we have today to speak to the public about some real issues, we play politics in the kind of vulgar way that Charles has just done. When we talk about, are you suggesting to me then that it is only the PNP councillors who are not seen or not felt? I believe it's across the board. I believe that individuals in their communities know that there are councillors across the board that are not performing. At the very least, the People's National Party is taking some step to deal with that. What is shocking is that the JLP would come here tonight and pretend that they have individuals, all of whom are performing, as if you sitting in your living room, you listening to us today, have no sense. You have not been on the ground. You have not been there where you are searching for your representative. Whoever they are, if you have not seen them, don't vote for them. That is where we need to take local government, and that's the kind of leadership that we require in local government.
You know, before we get
I also want to just go back a little bit as well. When we talk about the kind of leadership in the councils since 2012, let us be clear that local government does not operate like parliament. The decisions that are taken by all of council, every member voting. And I challenge anyone to tell me what has been those serious issues where the JLP members have objected to the decisions that have been taken.
Thank you very much, Team JLP.
Before my colleague follow up on the electoral process, I want to make it clear the difference between the JLP and the PNP with respect to local government candidates. We believe that local governance is all about the community. It's about you. We are not here for ourselves. We are here because we want to debate, because we want you to know why you're going to the poll. We don't want you to go to the poll simply because you are socialized a certain way to support a particular political party. We want you to go to the poll understanding the issues because we believe in your intelligence. The mayor of Kingston and St. Andrews seem to take this debate a very bit personal. I don't come here about myself. I come here on behalf of the people of Jamaica. But you know, given your attitude and your behavior, I think Damian Crawford was correct when he said that your influence does not go further than St. William Grand Park. I understand that. Now, also, the mayor spoke about the local government being not taking it not seriously. Let me say this. The difference between my strategy in dealing with local government is that, yes, I do my job every single day, and yes, I get myself qualified. But the only thing that the mayor of Kingston and St. Andrew have achieved over the past 4 years is a PhD. And I congratulate you. However, Kingston is a disgrace under your tenure. Kingston being a creative city, what has you contributed to make sure that we maximize on that? Nothing. Jamaicans, nothing. That's the reason why they have so many papers.
Thank you very much, Ms. Allen.
We come here because we're representing the truth.
Thank you very much, Ms. Allen. We have come to that time of the debates. My friends, we go to the closing statements. Team PNP, please go first.
Oh, yes. Thank you very much. And I go to my paper because there's nothing wrong in being prepared. Absolutely nothing wrong. But let me start by saying this. I want no one to take my passion and misunderstand that for being personal. But if you want to call it personal, let's go there. I take it personal because I have a passion for local government. I don't come here with platitudes, and I don't come here to insult individuals. I come here to talk about the issues. When individuals from Team JLP come and speak to us about corruption, when the minister himself has said, for example, that in Hanover, it is back in his good books. That's part of the problem. So I want to end by very, very simply saying a couple of things. One, minister, understand the difference between being minister and being mayor. It is about supervision, it is not about interference. Let us get that clear, let us get that straight. If we talk about what has been happening, today we have heard some statements that are totally, totally false. During this debate, we have been able to share our vision. I was hoping that we would have been able to understand a little bit more why you are important in this local government election and your role. Your role of helping us to fashion and identify our priorities, our budget, because public participation is really at the heart of the three strategic laws. Your say this time around is protected by law. Team PNP is up for the task. We ask you to join us and to ensure that you help us continue some of the work that we have started. We don't have to tell you lies because we have been working and you have been there. Miss Allen is too young to know that in Kingston, in St. William Grand Park, we have begun to do some things that say we are indeed a creative city.
And we now go to the Team JLP for your closing statement.
It is quite clear that the country will make a decision that will continue the path of progress that was started in February of this year. We have brought a new look to local government. We have been speaking with the people, we have listened to the concerns of the people, and we are acting on those concerns already. The failure of the previous administration to put in place the necessary systems to manage and to control the affairs of the local authority was not done. We have established the audit committee that is required. We are now making steps, and this is important. This administration will take the necessary steps to remove all political directorates as signatories to account in the various municipal cooperation across the country. Nowhere in the world is a politician a signatory to a checking account, and we are going to change that. We are going to put the mechanisms in place so that the municipal councils are held accountable to the people. You spoke about interference. It is my job to ensure that you do the right thing, and I make no apologies. I am doing it on behalf of the people. The people want transparency. I am willing to work. I have been working with you. I will continue that work. But the decision that the country needs to take is to choose between 4 years of disaster, 4 years of failure, 4 years of failing to comply with the basic requirements of the law, like what happened in Senan the other day, where the CEO advised do not withdraw the funds, but yet a PNP control administration went against the regulation. That is what the people have to decide on. The JLP is the best option for
local. Thank you very much, Mr. McKenzie. And in the true spirit of this debate, might I invite Mrs. Brown-Burke and Mr. McKenzie to come forward and shake hands, please. Come around, Mrs. Burke. And now you are allowed to chair. And might I quickly invite Miss Allen and Mr. Sinclair to shake hands with Mr. Fisher and Mr. Mitchell. Mr. Mitchell? Thank you. That concludes the first of two local government debates organized by the Jamaica Debates Commission in association with the Purity Bakery, Miss Birdie, the Petroleum Corporation of Jamaica, and the Donovan Geddes Foundation. Sign language interpretation was provided by Proven, listed on the Jamaica Stock Exchange. Broadband services were provided by Cable and Wireless Business. Join us again next Wednesday, November 23 at 9 p.m. for the debate focusing on local government issues. To view the debate again, please go to our website at www.jamaicadebatescommission.org. Thanks for joining us. Good night.